Welcome friends, today we are going to start our course on heat. So we are going to cover heat in multiple videos, starting with fundamentals of heat. And this is again brought to you by Real Learning Center, where we focus on real learning. So what are we going to do in this heat? We are going to cover basically three things: fundamental concepts like heat and temperature, etc. Specific heat, why does it expand, thermal expansion, when you heat something it expands, that part. And then we also will cover in the second one, our third and fourth video talks about heat transfer, how heat gets transferred from one place to the other. And finally in the third part, where basically again two videos, it will have change of phase or change of state, going from solid to liquid, liquid to gas and back to liquid, those kinds of things. So how heat can do that. So this is basically we have a place for the heat. So let's start with the fundamental concepts. Okay, and we are going to now start the first video, which is, we call it as heat one. Okay. So let's begin with a very simple question. Okay, so we do have here, you can see two things. Now one in a small beaker, some water is boiling, and in another a huge vessel, water is boiling. In both places, water is boiling. So water boiling in a small beaker, water boiling in a big vessel. So look at this, and we're going to ask a question. Okay, the question is, which one has, out of these two, okay, which one has more temperature? Whether this is having higher temperature or that is having higher temperature. That is our first question. Second question is, which one has more heat? Which one has more heat? Whether this one or that one. And the third question is, which one has more internal energy? Okay. So these three questions, if we can clearly answer, okay, then we will know the fundamentals of heat. Okay. We will get some insight into what is heat. So these three words we are going to first understand. Okay. So let's start with understanding how the solids are. Okay, look at, for example, I will take a very simple case of an aluminium bar. Okay, and I will take a very small portion of that in the aluminium bar, and then I will actually expand it. Okay, I will zoom it using a electron microscope, a lot of zooming. Okay, and if you carefully watch this. Okay, just watch that. It is actually not very, very stationary. Okay, you can carefully watch it. Now, these small atoms of aluminium are all packed together. We call it as a lattice, okay, crystal lattice, and they are packed together. And they are not stationary. They are just slightly wobbling. Okay, and if you actually even zoom it more, you will see the wobble better. Okay, if you zoom that more, you can see that it is actually really jiggling in its place. Okay, that is not apparent when you look at the aluminium. It is so strong, but actually inside things are slightly, you know, the atoms are actually not standing at one place. They are actually jiggling. Okay, now this kind of a movement, it is not only specific to aluminium. Okay, it is actually, you take anything. Okay, everywhere. Now, let's say I take skin. On the skin, if you take some molecules, organic molecules, so they will be jiggling like this. And if you take, for example, a metal lattice, they will be jiggling like that. Okay, so they are always just in some kind of a vibratory movement. Always. The molecules everywhere are always jiggling. So if you watch it through electron microscope, you will be able to see that. Now, since they are actually moving, okay, these movements involve kinetic energy. See, anything in motion has kinetic energy. Okay, that is guaranteed. That is half mv square, we can calculate. So anything in motion has kinetic energy. That means it is moving. Okay, it has some energy. It is moving. Okay. So now, the question basically is, what about liquids and gases? We just saw solid now. Are liquids and gases also like that? So in both cases, again, in liquids and gases, the molecules are still jiggling, not just jiggling, But you look at very carefully, in the case of a liquid, they actually move. They move over each other, they slide over each other, and the molecules keep moving over each other. And in gases, you see, they actually move randomly everywhere. And they hit the walls and hit each other, collisions happen like that. So, actually speaking, if you carefully watch, now the movement is more in the case of gas and slightly less in the case of liquid. But it is a lot of movement when compared to solid. So we can say liquid molecules have more kinetic energy than solid. Solid was just jiggling. Here it is moving. Okay, and we can also say that gas molecules have even more kinetic energy because they are moving off and bouncing and coming back and all that. They have even more kinetic energy. So now we understood that both all solid, liquid and gas, all of them, all the molecules always have some kinetic energy in them. So what happens to the molecules when you heat them? Now that you know they are always jiggling, we saw. Now what happens when you actually heat them? So you take the molecules, okay, and you see the left one basically is not heated, right one is heated. So when you heat them, they actually jiggle more. So there is more kinetic energy. When you heat them, they move more and hence have more kinetic energy. And you can also see that even water molecules move very fast and sometimes they even escape from the surface of the water and become steam. So when you heat, they actually get more kinetic energy. Higher temperature, the molecules have higher kinetic energy because they move faster. And also, okay, materials expand when heated. Now you can see very clearly this one is not heated and that one is heated. Since it is taking more space while moving, it is slightly expanded. So that is the reason it expands when heated. So two things happen. One, they will have more kinetic energy. Two, they expand because they occupy a little more space when jiggling. Okay. Now, the question is, that is what is heat doing to the material, we know. So now the question that comes is, what is this temperature? What is temperature? Okay, do we know it? So this word temperature, we will define it in a very simple way. Let's understand this. So let's take, for example, this is considered to be the average kinetic energy of the molecules. In the sense that all molecules have kinetic energy. So what is the meaning of average kinetic energy of the molecules? Average kinetic energy of the molecules simply means that let us say you take kinetic energy of each and every molecule. There are like crores of molecules. You take each and every molecule and find out how fast it is moving and you add up all the kinetic energy. Okay, and then you divide that by the number of molecules. So that is called average kinetic energy of a molecule. So that average kinetic energy of the molecule is basically the direct representation of the temperature into certain value, okay, certain some constant if you put, you will get the temperature. So it gives you the temperature is simply proportional to the average kinetic energy. Okay, it is not proportional to the total kinetic energy. We have to understand that. It is never proportional to the total kinetic energy. It is proportional to the average kinetic energy. Add all of them, divided by that, like that. So that is basically our definition of temperature. So now how do we actually measure the temperature? Okay. So measuring the temperature does not mean actually going and measuring the kinetic energy of every molecule, like crores of molecules, and then adding that up and dividing it by the number of molecules. That is very hard. There are easier ways to measure. So what we are going to do is we'll figure out how do we measure the temperature. So we first take a little bit of mercury, it is also it's a liquid, a metal, so into one glass like this, okay, and then we will basically put some candle and heat it up, okay. So when you keep heating up, you can see very clearly that mercury is rising because it's expanding. When you keep heating it, mercury will be rising because it is expanding. And if you switch it off, remove the candle, it keeps cooling down and it will come down to the normal level. So that is the how anything behaves. When you heat it up, it expands. When you cool it, it contracts. And we saw why it is so, okay, because of the higher amount of jiggling. Now, what we will do is, we will take one such mercury along with the tube and put that with the ice, we'll put that in the ice. Okay. The moment you put that in the ice, it cools down, it contracts and mercury level goes low. Okay. Once mercury level goes low, then you mark that level. Okay. You say that level I will call as 0 degree centigrade. We call this level as 0 degree centigrade. Okay. Then we will take it and put it in boiling water. So then mercury actually keeps rising, and it reaches certain point and stops there. It doesn't rise anymore. Okay. So that point we will basically mark it and call it 100. Okay. So once you have two marks on the tube, one is 0, another is 100. Then what we are going to do? We are going to take take basically a marker and put 100 divisions, equal divisions inside that. So 100 equal division. That is why it is called centigrade. Centi means 100. So we make 100 equal divisions. So this is called 100 degree centigrade. So this is how we say water actually boils at 100 degree centigrade and freezes ice at 0 degree centigrade. So why means that is how we define the centigrade. We took whatever water is boiling and called it 100. Whatever water is freezing and called it 0. Okay, that is how we define the centigrade with respect to water. So this, there's a lot of work done by a guy called Celsius. Okay, so his name is Celsius, is Andreas Celsius. So who created a similar temperature grade? We use instead of centigrade, we call it as Celsius also. C when we write it is that is what it means. Okay. So this is our thermometer. That's how you make a thermometer. Okay, so it's very easy to make. Take some liquid mercury and put it inside a tube. Maybe you do it a little bit of vacuum inside, because if it expands, somewhere the air has to go. No? So make it vacuum, and then simply do this experiment. No? Put it at ice and put it in water and hot water and mark it and make it. Thermometer. That is how a thermometer is made. That is how we. Then onwards, you take this thermometer, okay, and put wherever you want, and you can see it rises to 35 degrees, 45 degrees, 50 degrees. You can measure after that once you made this, okay. So now that is how you measure temperature. So the question now is, in thermometer, mercury expands as temperature increases, okay. That is thing that we saw. And we also know that the glass tube which holds to the mercury, that also should expand, no? Why is that not expanding? So in that case, no, if both of them expand, won't that basically nullify each other, and hence there is no rise in the mercury level? If both mercury also expanded and glass also expanded, so it will not increase the level at all. Can that happen like that? So what is the answer to that? So think about it a little bit. So the answer to that is, actually, mercury and glass, both of them really expand. But mercury actually expands much more than the glass. Okay. The reason is that generally, metals expand more than non-metals. And liquids expand more than solids. Okay. So mercury being a metal and a liquid, it expands more than glass. Hence, we can see that liquid mercury expands much higher than solid glass. So we can use it for our measurements, not a problem. Okay. So now we understood very nicely what is temperature, and we also understood how to measure the temperature. So now the next question that comes is, what is this heat then? Okay. So till now we thought temperature and heat are all same. So is it same or it is different? So that question is the next question. So to answer that question, okay, we will have to look at a little bit of history about heat. Okay, it's a very interesting history about heat. So what happened was, till about a very long time back, people thought that fire was an element. Like, you know, we have this carbon is an element, hydrogen is an element. Like that, people thought that the fire is an element, and they named it also. It is called phlogiston. Fire was supposed to be an element for a very long time, hundreds of years. People thought that fire was actually an element, phlogiston. And one guy actually disproved it. So that guy name is called Antonio Levasseur, and this is he is actually a French guy who is considered to be the father of chemistry. He did a lot of work in chemistry. So he, in 1770, he discovered oxygen. Okay, when he discovered oxygen, he said that water is not an element. Okay, oxygen and water put together is actually oxygen and hydrogen put together is actually water. Hydrogen is an element, oxygen is an element, but put together is water is a compound. That's what he said. And at the same time, what happened, he showed that they were thinking this hydrogen to be, you know, some fire to be an element called phlogiston. So he showed very clearly that fire is not at all an element. It is just a form of energy. Okay. So when he proved that, then people actually started a completely new understanding of fire. But he gave an explanation of heat flow. Okay. So his explanation of heat flow was even more interesting. He said that heat actually is kind of transferred from place to place, from hot body to cold body, using a kind of a fluid, caloric. There is some invisible fluid called caloric. Whenever you keep one hot body and one cold body, this caloric actually flows from the hot body to the cold body. And he didn't stop there. He said there is one more fluid called as frigoric, which actually is always flowing from cold body to the hot body. So caloric goes from hot to cold, and frigoric goes from cold to hot. So like that, he said. And then after, very quickly, people have figured out that there is no need of an explanation for cold frigoric going from there to here. So you can work with just caloric. So they said that, okay, forget frigoric, it is always only caloric which flows from hot to cold. Okay, that is sufficient to explain everything. And this kind of an explanation, okay, was there for quite some time. Okay, how long? Till our molecular explanation of what a heat is jiggling around and all we talked about now. Before that, this was the explanation. And this explanation didn't die out very fast. No? This explanation was there for at least a century, for 100 years. All people, all scientists, everybody believed that heat is actually flowing through something called as a fluid called frigoric. Okay. So what is heat then? So heat is actually considered to be something which flows from the hot object to the cold object. We always say that heat is a form of energy. It is not a liquid. It is not a fluid. It is a form of energy. It flows from hot object to the cold object. It always flows from hot object to the cold object. And there is nothing like cold flowing from cold object to the hot object. Always heat flows from hot object to the cold object. That is all. Okay. And we cannot say that an object has heat, because heat is only a flowing thing. It is flowing energy is called heat. What is the heat of this object, we cannot ask, because heat is actually the energy in transit. It is going. Okay, that is called as heat. And also, heat is heat flows from higher temperature to lower temperature. That we have to understand. It is always going from higher temperature to the lower temperature, that energy. So we cannot ask a question, which has more heat? We can't ask that, because nothing has heat. It is all flowing only. Okay, so that is a wrong question to ask. So now we have basically kind of a good understanding of what is heat. And heat is actually measured in terms of something called as joules. SI unit for heat is joules. Okay. So now, though calorie is still used as the unit to measure heat, no? Though joules is there, there is another unit called calorie. That old caloric fluid influence is still there. We call we measure heat in terms of another unit called calorie. Okay, though in the SI unit it is called joules. Okay. So now we understood temperature, we understood heat. So now we talk about what is this internal energy. Okay. Now if you take these molecules, now these molecules, I said jiggle. Okay. They keep moving. But this jiggling is not limited to just moving like this from place to place. From here to here, here to back here, here to here, back here. That is called vibration. No? It's not just that much. So you consider, for example, a molecule like this, maybe a water molecule. Okay. So it actually vibrates in much more different ways. So you look at this. The distance between hydrogen and oxygen is increasing and decreasing like this. And the length also is moving separately in the second picture, you can see. And you can also see that the angle also is changing like this. Okay. So there are multiple ways you can see that a molecule can dance. Molecule can dance in multiple ways. Okay. And every kind of dance, every kind of dance has some energy needed and associated with this. Okay. It has energy in different ways. Now, this whole energy, internal energy is nothing but the total energy. So you take, what is the energy required to do dance like this? What is the energy required to do dance like this? What is the energy required to do, you know, this kind of dance? All of them you basically put together, add together, and that is called as internal energy. Okay. So molecules have various other kinds of movements, that's what we say, and each movement has associated kinetic energy, and each position has associated potential energy. It is not only that, you know, you take, if the two molecules come near, it's like a spring action. When they come near, they want, if you press a spring, what happens? Spring has to go back. No? So that is some stored energy. That's called potential energy. So when you get a molecule near to other molecule, and it is at that point, depending on its position, it has some potential energy. So it has kinetic energy, it has potential energy. So all of them you add together, and that is basically called as the internal energy. Okay, all these energies, if you total it, it's called internal energy. And what is very important is that the temperature, okay. So the internal energy has no direct relation to temperature at all. So if temperature is higher, that means internal energy is higher. We can't say like that. There is no relationship with that. So temperature is only related to the average kinetic energy of the movement, of the whole molecule movement. The molecule dancing, it does not have. Molecule movement here and there, that movement is what actually is associated with the temperature. Okay. All the kinetic energy, if you take off this kind of a movement, side movement, okay, and front movement and all, that is basically added together and divided by the number of molecules will give you the temperature. But the total internal energy simply means all of them, if you add together, that is internal energy. Temperature has no relation to the internal energy. Only translational kinetic energy. Translation means full molecule movement. Only that has relation to temperature. Okay. So now you can ask and get back and ask this original question. Okay. Water boiling in a small beaker, water boiling in a big vessel. So which has more temperature, more heat, and more internal energy? So can you answer that question now? After this understanding, I hope you can answer. Okay. So you pause the video here and answer, and then go forward. Okay. So now you go to the next step, and I will give you the answer. Okay. The answer is definitely they have both same temperature. So thermometer, if you put them boiling point 100 degrees centigrade, both of them have same temperature. That means average kinetic energy of both scenarios is exactly same. Okay. And heat, what about heat? It's a wrong question. Okay, we said we cannot ask a question which has more heat. How much it is flowing, that question we can ask. We cannot ask which has more heat. Okay, that's a wrong question. And which has more internal energy? Of course, the big one has more internal energy, no? Because it has more molecules. So every molecule has some amount of energy, no? Associated with its movement, and it's dancing around different kinds of dances. Now you keep adding all of them for this one, and keep adding all of them for the big one. So the big one has more molecules and naturally has more internal energy, because the average kinetic energy is same. So that's why temperature is same. So if you multiply with the number of molecules, you get more energy for the other one. Okay, so that is our answer. Now, do you agree? I think you agree. Okay. So let's just take stock. What we learned? We learned basically what is temperature, what is heat, and what is internal energy. Those are the three basic foundations on which basically we will develop our concept of heat. So we still need to study a lot of things, you know, specific heat, thermal expansion, and all that. So we'll move forward for that. Before moving forward, actually, I will give you some questions. Okay. So these questions will be useful for you to think about give an answer. So true or false? Temperature is a measure of total kinetic energy of a substance. In a substance, is it true or false? Think and answer. Okay. Second question is, suppose you apply flame to 1 liter of water for certain amount of time, and the temperature rises by about 2 degrees. So if you apply same flame for the same time for 2 liters of water, more water, okay, how much will be the increase in temperature? Think and answer with your understanding of average kinetic energy and all that. Okay. And lastly, this is a question to explore. Think about it, discuss with others. Okay. It is, a fast marble hits a random scatter of slow moving marbles. There are the slow moving marbles here, and randomly one fast marble comes and hits it. Now, does the fast marble usually speed up or slow down when that happens? That is the question. Okay. Which loses kinetic energy and which gains kinetic energy? So that is an easy question to answer, I suppose. But the next part is important. The initially fast moving marble, are the initially moving, slow moving marble, which one will lose kinetic energy, which one will gain? So the question basically is, how do these questions actually relate to the direction of heat transfer? How are you going to relate this to the direction of heat transfer? So think about it and wait for the next video on heat. So where we will talk about the specific heat and the thermal expansion, etc. Thank you.